of all, I want to say that, yes, I am a trade unionist since many, many years, because I'm very old. And at the same time, since some years, I have not only I, but together with others of my union, that, by the way, is a metal workers union in Italy, and is one of the unions who are more trying to resist, and I will say something about this. But since, I think, 2000 or 2001, or maybe 1999, I've been and we have been joining and participating in the general movement that we call the movement of the movements that started, yes, I could say at Seattle in 1999 against the WTO. And this because we really think, and today maybe even more, we really think that the situation in general, the situation of globalization and the impact of this on people conditions, workers, and in general citizens conditions, and today the strong and very heavy crisis cannot have a single answers, neither at national level, although national level, I will say something about our country, is quite important, but they must have an answer at European and supranational level. So my answer to the question that is the title of our panel is yes. Is another Europe possible? And is yes, because I think that we need another Europe. And when I talk about this, I mean Europe society, Europe citizenship, European civil society, and of course European politics. But I would like to speak more from the point of view of civil society, and in particular also about the workers' movement, labor movement, trade union movement, that are today in a very, very, I think, deep crisis. Deep crisis like everywhere, like the crisis of the movements, but the deep crisis is related to the fact that although at national level, and this is about your question, although at national level we have resistances, we have strong struggle, but we are in a situation, like an Italian professor says, that there is a strong class struggle. But now the class struggle is driven by the other parties, not driven like it was for tenth and hundreds of years by the worker class. It is driven by the other, I would say, what is the new holy alliance between International Monetary Fund, European Commission, European Central Bank, and I would add the fourth. And the fourth actor of this alliance is the system of economic, financial power, and in particular the multinationals. And I say this because the case of Italy, that is not the only case, but in Italy I think is very, very visible today, that the combination of the attack, economic and social attack of the multinational, the case of Fiat in Italy is, I think, more or less known, and Mr. Marchionne, the CEO of Fiat, the combination of this with the austerity policies today represented and acted by the second M, the Monti government, is a very clear example of how this alliance is acting a class struggle where we are not now winning, but is one of the reasons why we need not to be alone all together with trade unions and social movements. Why? Because in Italy, attack to the rights, work rights, social rights, citizens' rights, was first launched by exactly the CEO of Fiat, Marchionne, with a very heavy blackmail to the workers, saying these are my rules, these are my requests, either these are accepted in terms of attack to the collective bargaining, attack to the condition, work conditions, attack to the rights of the people, either do you accept this or I will go elsewhere. And this was the first point where unfortunately, there was no a collective and unitarian answer of the unions. We decided, as our union, we decided not to accept and not to sign. And we decided this because of the push of many workers who did not want to be submitted to this blackmail and to refuse. And we are in this situation today of resistance to an imposition of a very, very authoritarian model, social model, and this authoritarian social model, this cut of democracy inside the working place up to exclude the union who said no, our union, from the representation inside the workplace, so we are out. We are present because people are members, but as a representation we are out. This attack to democracy was very strongly supported also by the policy of the government, with the two, mainly with the two big so-called reforms that we call counter-reforms about labor market, employment and workers' rights, and about pensions. About work and labor market was the reform, the so-called reform that we expected to be against the precarization of work is actually the contrary. Is we have 46 type of contracts, and the 46 type of contracts are still there. Second, dismissals, individual dismissals are easier now because of the change of the law, the statute of workers' law. And third, the counter-reform of pensions, that is to bring the age of pensions up to 67 years. And this is, although they have been always talking about the needs of young people, the problem of work and employment for young people. Of course, when you have such a reform, when people are obliged to go up to 67 years of for the pension, this is against the employment. And this is true because the employment and the unemployment rate is growing in a very strong way. So this to this, there is a opposition, resistance, and we think that this is needed because although we believe that the reasons for the crisis are inside this kind of model, and we have to change this kind of development model, without a resistance that try to protect the rights that have been achieved long 100 years, we will not be able at all to change any part of this or any fundament of this model. Last point, then I have more, but I want just to say last point on this because you asked about the European answer. As I said, I think at trade union level, the crisis is very clear. The European Confederation of Trade Unions, that is the only one actor in Europe, labor union at the European level is very weak. It's actually not a union, it's a group of national unions together, and who are the strongest decide what to do. And what was impressive, I mentioned just this case because it's really something that gives an idea of how it works. When the struggle in Greece started, that was 2010 or a little bit before the decision of the European Confederation of Trade Unions to have a European day of action. We cannot say European strike because it does not exist, neither in the Nice Charter of Rights nor in the Lisbon Treaty. It does not exist, and for many countries like Germany, for instance, just to say the most powerful, is not allowed the political strike, is not allowed the solidarity strike. So there was this action, but before this, the Greek had been fighting with several general strikes. And then there was just one. So this to say that there is this weakness at institutional level, but what I think is more to take in account is that the solidarity among workers is, of course, weakened by the situation of crisis, because everyone tries, of course, to keep their jobs. Everyone is frightened by the blackmails, because it's not only the Fiat, but everywhere. This everyone is frightened by the attack to the collective and individual rights. So the question of solidarity and the rebuilding of a solidarity among workers and of workers together with other movements and social movements is quite urgent. And this one, also this of the reason why I think we have to build up, to rebuild up, to reconnect all the actors, social actors in Europe in order to have another Europe. So the first other Europe must come from ourselves.
Okay, so,